Good morning.
Good morning.
There is coffee back there. So it's good to be with all of you. Gary, thank you for your kindness, and I appreciate the invitation to be part of this. I'm so delighted that we could do this as part of the gospel in the city in partnership, because it struck me as I was thinking about this a couple days ago, I think it's pretty tricky to say that we're committed to the city and not do much about the workplace, because you know, business and the workplace, I mean, that's a pretty significant part of the city. And so that's why I think this connection between faith and the workplace is such an important part of our outreach and ministry to the city. I'm in kind of an interesting space here, as Gary suggested, because I teach business students. I also teach seminary students in ethics. And Jeremy and I were talking about some of the ethical issues that he's facing in the pastorate, and we're trying to get the next generation of pastors to really engage a lot of these ethical issues and to help the business folks, the workplace folks who they serve, to meaningfully connect Sunday and Monday, not just Sunday and Monday, but Sunday with Monday through Friday for the rest of their week. And in fact, some time ago, I just sat down and did the math on this, and I started to think about how many hours a week the average person in the church that I go to spends in the workplace versus the average number of hours per week that he or she spends in the church building. And it was staggering, the difference. I mean, the average person that I go to church with works 50 to 60 hours a week and at best spends 5 hours a week in the church building. And I thought, it would stand to reason, just by virtue of the time, wouldn't it, that the workplace might actually be the primary crucible in which God is working out people's spirituality and their spiritual formation. Not to say that what happens in the church building is not important, because it's crucial, but just in terms of the time, it seems to me that the workplace, I think it may end up being the primary place that God is at work molding and shaping the people that we serve. And it seems to me, what I tell my seminary students is a big part of the pastor's responsibility is to help people in the workplace have their antenna up so that they can actually see and recognize the things that God is doing in their lives to shape them spiritually through what goes on in the workplace. I think, in my experience, we've been largely missing on that in my own church. But where my passion for this comes from really is the experience of my dad. My dad was what I would call a serial entrepreneur. In fact, I have vivid memories of, as a middle school student, our family sitting around the dining room table, and my dad not asking us, but announcing to us that he was putting everything that he had saved for college for myself and my two siblings into this startup business that he was getting ready to launch. And I remember thinking, you know, I wasn't all that savvy as a 12 or 13-year-old, but I knew that if this business went down the tubes, I was on my own for college. Now, it turned out, at the end of the day, that was a really good investment of our college funds. It paid for college many times over. But I remember my dad came to faith a little later in life, when he was in his 40s, when I was a high school student. And it took him a long time to get involved in a church that actually taught God's word well. And I remember my dad never made the connection between his faith and what he was doing in the workplace. And he ran a business, I think, sort of accidentally, in some very Christian ways. I mean, he had about 250 employees. He knew every one of them by name, made it a point to take the first hour of the day to walk through the plant and greet everybody by name and ask them about their life and keep up with them. But the only thing he ever got from his church about how to connect his faith with what was going on in the workplace was that churches collect revenue and somebody's got to be out there generating it. Or as a student of mine put a while back, she said, business people in my church were viewed as pockets to be picked. I thought that's the only connection he ever made. And as much as we talked about it, I could not get him past that. And there, I remember even after he died, have really profound sadness that he never got the richer biblical connection between his faith and what goes on in the workplace. And see, I think this is really important for not only for people who are in the workplace, but for people who are anticipating being there, for our high school and college students. And here's what I've picked up. I got this from my son. And I was talking to Jeremy about this because all three of my kids are artists. And my son is a theater guy. And I remember he went through a very good high school group. And I remember talking to him about what is, you know, kind of spiritual life and spiritual growth. And he, and all the only thing he had made that connection with was church stuff. And spiritual growth and church stuff were the things that were connected. He never once connected his spirituality with his passion, which is theater and the stage. And I think this is the stuff that actually, if I were a youth pastor, this would keep me awake at night. But I think my son felt like because he wasn't heading for a pastorate or the mission field, that he was somehow getting a pass on having to really take his faith seriously. That because he wasn't preparing for what we call, I think theologically erroneously, full-time ministry, he actually was getting a pass, an exemption from really having to be sold out in his faith. So that's, I come to this with passion because of my family. And I've seen how this has affected the people who I care about the most. So I asked my seminary students to tell me about their work before coming to seminary. And it's really interesting how many of them will say, well, I was just an accountant. I was just a salesperson. I was just, but they feel like when they come to seminary, they're now actually doing something that really matters. Or I put it like this. I'll say, if you took a poll of people in your church, how do you think they would connect their faith with what they do in the marketplace? And I get more deer in the headlights looks from my students than I know what to do with on that. And then I'll ask them, how do you think that people in the workplace are perceived in our churches? I had some really interesting answers to that. I had one. I was in Australia a few weeks ago as part of some speaking I did for the Presbyterian Church, and I was talking about this subject, and I had somebody say, you know, the way business people are perceived, we have a very prominent business person in our church, and he is called, he is called the distinguished ATM. And I thought, you've got to be kidding. Please tell me that's not true. Or I have some of my students will say things like, they are seen as simply sources of funding for the church. They see business people, or they see business people as having savvy to help us administrate the church. That gets kind of mixed reviews when I ask pastors about that, because sometimes we don't appreciate that businesses and churches are two fundamentally different types of things. Or they view business people as having value because of what I call the strategic soapbox for living out and communicating your faith. Because I think they rightly recognize that many of the people who are in the marketplace, they have contact with folks who will likely never darken the doors of our churches. In fact, I get a kick out of people in the workplace who lament that they are the only Christian in their particular workplace. And I look at them sort of wide-eyed and say, you mean to tell me that God has entrusted that whole organization to you? You know, it's unbelievable, but it's true. Or they'll say something like, you know, I use my business as a way to get into parts of the world that are closed to the gospel. We have increasing number of students who will say some things that I think are decidedly less encouraging than these. They will say things like, you know, business people they're not on the front lines. They don't feel like they're on the front lines of what God's doing in the world. I was at a well-known Christian camp outside the state of California some time ago, and a very prominent pastor from the area was giving a series of messages at night, and he was talking about a relationship to a business person that he had in his church. And the business person was describing his relationship to the pastor like this. He said, "Pastor, you're on the front lines, and I'm the supply line. And if my wife hadn't been with me, I think I might have gotten up and said something. Because she would have, of course, pulled me back down into my seat. But I thought, what a backward view of the church that views what goes on in the building as the front lines. I mean, that's like the soldier who goes to boot camp and says, I think I'll stay here because that's where all the action is. No, the action is out in the world, in the city, in the world, primarily in the workplace. I think regularly I encounter folks in the workplace who feel like they are doing something less than for God's kingdom than are the men and women who are earning a paycheck from a church or other Christian organization. I get this with my students, my seminary students, all the time. Because my seminary students will say things like, I left my business to go serve the Lord full time. And I look at them and say, now I'm just getting a little more blunt about it. I used to say, you know, well, tell me exactly what you thought you were doing in your business. Now I just look at them and say, where did you learn such terrible theology? I said, hopefully not at our place. Or they will say, I have lots of students, my seminary students, who are what we call bivocational. I suspect we have many of you who are in this room. Now, who they're doing something in the workplace to pay the bills as a way of, as they put it, freeing them up to do the thing that really matters in their life. And I've always objected to the term tent making to describe that because it implies that it's something less than what people are doing in the local church. And I think tent making, isn't that good enough to honor God? Why do we simply, by saying that pastor is bivocational, we are generally, not always, but generally viewing the workplace as strictly a means to an end, not an end in itself. I think that's a profoundly unbiblical way of looking at the workplace. And then some of you in this room are old enough to have read the book Halftime. Right, I'm not asking for a show of hands on that. But Halftime, it was a very popular book years ago. It was written by a very successful business person whose thesis was at halftime of your life, when you've kind of been there and done that in business and, you know, raised your kids and they're up and out of the house, and you have the chance to reassess your gifts and skills and passions. And as he puts it, move from success to significance. And in the second half of your life, you're about kingdom work. Well, I wanted to ask, what did you think you were doing in the first half of your life? Why was that not also kingdom work? And it reflects, I think, a view of the workplace theologically that is not so much incorrect as it is incomplete. And I've been banging this drum with my seminary students for several years now. And you'll be very encouraged to know there's now a network of 20 different seminaries that have, you know, huge programs involving, we're one of them, to integrate a theology of work and vocation into the fabric of the theological curriculum so that the hierarchy that we often sense in many of our churches where, you know, pastors and missionaries are at the top of the pile and everybody else is somehow down on a lower rung, we can start to address that in a more systematic way. But let's look theologically at this and get, and I'm not going to go sort of verse by verse, but I want to look at more the big picture, the big story of the Bible, the grand narrative of the Bible, and see where work fits into this. Obviously, our work has instrumental value. We work in order to accomplish a lot of other things that the Bible calls us to. Nobody really debates that. The discussion is about the intrinsic value of what goes on in the workplace in terms of service to Christ and serving the kingdom. And that's the part that theologically I'm not sure we always get. Okay? So look in the big story of the Bible. In fact, I ask my seminary students, they almost always get this right. But when I ask groups of business people this question, I get a mixed response. I ask, when did God ordain work? In Genesis 2 or 3? Okay, which is it? Please give me unanimity here. It's in Genesis 2, right? Please say that. The correct answer to that would be yes, that's right. If I ask that to a group of business people in my church, I get about, am I doing something wrong here? I get about a 50-50 response. I have lots of business people who view their work as their penalty, introduced after the entrance of sin. And even if they don't say it that way, they often view it that way. They view their work as somehow a consequence of the general entrance of sin. And I remind them that in Genesis 3, God cursed the ground. He did not curse work. Those are two different things. And God ordained work in paradise in Genesis 2:15 as the primary mechanism by which the dominion mandate was carried out. Now, God also ordained procreation to accomplish that because Adam and Eve could not do it by themselves. But in Genesis 1 and 2, there's actually, in the original text, there's a purpose clause that links human beings being made in the image of God and the task of exercising dominion over creation. That we were part of the purpose in Genesis 1 and 2 for being made in the image of God was so that we could work. Now, we also know from the early chapters of Genesis that God is portrayed as a worker right out of the gate. In Genesis 1, he rests from his work. In Genesis 2, he ordains it. He ordains the Sabbath after the model of creation later on in the law. Throughout the Old Testament, God is seen as working to uphold and sustain his creation. And in Jesus, in one of his strongest claims to be God, claimed to be working on the Sabbath as my Father is still working. So at the beginning bookend of biblical history, work plays a fairly dominant role. Work is a significant part of what God was calling human beings to do from the beginning. In paradise. Now, of course, in Genesis 3, the entrance of sin complicates things. But it did not wipe out the nobility of work. It complicated the workplace so that you have things like injustice in the workplace. You have things like sweatshops. You have sexual harassment. You have ethical dilemmas, all those kinds of things. And I point out to my business students that the organizations that you will go to work for will have some of those problems because you will be in them. Right? Now, we're trying to minimize that with the stuff we do about character and integrity. But, you know, all of our business students, I mean, they're miserable, wretched, depraved sinners just like the rest of us. And that's why I'm not sure our churches are exempt. In fact, I'm sure they're not from some of those same kinds of things. Now, at the ending bookend of biblical history, and this is tough for people who are in the workplace to choke down sometimes. But after the Lord returns, the Bible is very clear that you will still be working. Right? Now, for a lot of business people, that's breaking news. That's not always great news, because a lot of business people I know are working as hard as they can to get as much money as fast as they can to retire as soon as they can. And the idea that when the Lord returns, people will still be working is not that's not a comforting thought to many of them. But when the prophets talk about the kingdom in its consummation, some of the figures of speech they use sound like this. They will beat their swords into what?
Plowshares.
And their spears into pruning hooks, which means that the implements of war
will be transformed into the implements of productive work, which suggests that when the Lord returns, we will all still be working. Okay, now I'm not too sure about the getting a paycheck part, you know, but I suspect we will still have exchange and a medium of exchange. It's just that we'll have a marketplace and an economy that's free from sin and corruption. Although I admit, I'm still having a hard time wrapping my arms around exactly what that's going to look like, but it's going to be a big improvement. I know that. Now, think about, the way the book ends treat this, I think, suggests, particularly from Genesis 1 and 2, of what the British novelist Dorothy Sayers put it like this, that work is not what one does to live, but the thing one lives to do, the medium in which he or she offers himself or herself to God. I love the way the late Chuck Colson put it. He said, I think he's right about this. He said, we are hardwired for work as part of being made in the image of God. It's part of our spiritual DNA. And I take the image of God to be more a representation of our status with God. And we represent him in the workplace by virtue of being made in his image. Right. Now, I think this is why Solomon can put it like this in Ecclesiastes. I mean, look at the language that he used. This is very stark language to talk about work in a fallen world. In Ecclesiastes 2:24, he puts it like this. Okay, a person can do nothing better. Okay? That bar is pretty high. Than to eat and drink and find satisfaction in their own work. This too I see is from the hand of God, for without him who can eat or find enjoyment? Right? Now that, I would suggest to you, that is not sort of pagan, Epicurean, eat, drink, and be merry for tomorrow we die philosophy. That is sober, biblical truth about how to live in a fallen world this side of eternity. And he makes the same point down just one chapter down. In Ecclesiastes 3, verse 12, I know that there is nothing better for people than to be happy and to do good while they live, that each of them may eat and drink and find satisfaction in all their work. This is the gift of God. God's good, being able to work is part of God's good gift to us. Now, I think this goes even further in the New Testament when Paul, I think, and one of the clearest statements of this is in Colossians chapter 3. It said, in whatever you do, right? Now think about that. That's a pretty big tent. Work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for human masters, since you'll know you'll receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. Now, parenthesis, in whatever you do, it's the Lord Christ whom you are serving. Right? Now look, if you look down one verse in verse 22, you'll see the audience for this. It's a very specific audience. It's slaves, obey your human masters in everything. Slaves, in whatever you do, work at it with all your heart. Slaves, in whatever you do, it's the Lord Christ whom you are serving. Arguably, the people engaged in the most mind-numbing, mindless grunt work that you could have imagined in the first century. Yet, Paul affirms that their work has nobility and is, not all of it, but a part of their service to Christ. Or to put it a little differently, it is their ministry. In fact, the term is the same, diakonia, which we translate ministry, is most commonly translated service. And I think it's actually a clearer way to see this. Now, I often ask people who are in the workplace, I say, tell me about your ministry in the workplace. What kind of things do you think they respond with? They say things like, well, I pray for my coworkers. Every once in a while I get a chance to tell somebody about my faith, or I get a chance to be of service or compassion to someone, a coworker whose life is falling apart, things like that. At which point, I take the opportunity to point out to them that all the things they are describing as their ministry in the workplace are those things that they are doing when they are not doing their jobs, which I find really enlightening to think about. It's very rare that I find a business person or somebody in the workplace who views the work itself as part of their service to Christ. And I think this is the one thing I've been trying so hard to get my seminary students to get, to affirm to the workplace folks that they serve that the very work they do is their ministry. Now, it's not all of it. It's an arena of service that they are called to. They're called to multiple arenas of service or multiple vocation. That's, I think, a vocation is simply an arena of service to Christ. And you have those in the workplace, you have them in your family, you have them in your neighborhood, your local church, a lot of different places. But I find it so troubling that we so rarely, at least in the churches I'm in connection with, connect the day-to-day stuff of what goes on in the workplace with their service to Christ. I have a friend of mine who got this. They have a really interesting way of describing this. He and his wife were coming back from an overseas vacation, and on the jetway getting off the airplane, she blacked out, completely unconscious, right there on the jetway. They rushed her to a neurosurgeon. Turned out she had a tumor about the size of a quarter at the base of her brain, and it was causing all these blackouts. They rushed her to neurosurgery, and with outpatient surgery, with what's called a gamma knife, which had just come on the market, they excised the tumor, and she went home that same day. And to the best of my knowledge, it has had no recurrence of this. Well, my friend was reflecting on all the different occupations that had to come together to facilitate her healing. And he was particularly taken with the imaging software that enabled the surgeon to pinpoint exactly where the tumor was and to minimize collateral damage to the brain. You know what he said? He said, "I am so glad that the person who wrote that imaging software didn't decide to leave their business to go serve the Lord full time." And I thought, he got it. That's exactly the concept. If you go over to our business school, you know, they got it just right too. There's a banner about the size of that screen that hangs down from the business school. You can't miss it when you walk in. It says, "Business as ministry. Business as service to Christ," where you are not only serving the community. I think that the work, what we do in the workplace, actually is the primary arena in which we fulfill the mandate to love our neighbor. I find it so hard. We hardly ever apply the notion to loving our neighbor to the customers that we serve, to the clients that we have through our office, that the employees that work for us, our co-workers that work with us. But I think the primary place, as a dean here, the primary place in which I have the opportunity to fulfill the mandate to love my neighbor is with the faculty who report to me. I went years before I ever thought about it in those terms. Now, let's look just one other passage of scripture here, and then we'll open it up for some questions. It's interesting in the book of Acts how this idea of ministry and service is used. In Acts chapter 6, this is actually, I think, the first time in the New Testament that the term ministry is used to describe something besides preaching and teaching. Remember, in Acts chapter 6, they were having major racial issues, racial tensions in the church. And there was a group of elderly widows who were being neglected, and it was causing huge discord in the church. And in Acts chapter 6, 1 and 2, they put it like this. "In those days, when the number of disciples was increasing, the Hellenistic or Greek-speaking Jews among them complained against the Hebraic Jews because their widows were being overlooked in the daily," literally, "daily diakonia," or ministry, "of food. So the 12 gathered all the disciples together and said, 'It would not be right for us to neglect the diakonia of the word of God, the ministry of the word of God, in order to wait on tables.'" Get the import of that? The same term used for the service of preaching and the service of waiting on tables in the world. Both of those are called ministry. Both of those are service. And I think there's a form of service that was better subjectively for the apostles because that's what they were gifted to do. But I don't think you can make a case biblically that those are objectively better arenas of service. This is why it so troubles me when I hear people say, you know, I'm in full-time ministry, describing the pastorate. Now, don't get me wrong. Pastorate is a noble, noble calling. And those of you who are in it, God bless you. If I was going to do an easier job, I'd do something like be a neurosurgeon. I don't think there are too many jobs that are more difficult than pastoring today. But think about if we substitute the term service for ministry, how much clearer this becomes. Because when do people enter full-time service for Christ? When is that? Is it when they decide where they're going to get a paycheck from? I'd like to think it's a whole lot earlier than that. When is it? It's when people come to faith, isn't it? Every believer is in full-time service. In fact, how do you leave full-time service? I love the people who say, well, I'm leaving the ministry. I said, no, you're not. Unless you've defected from your faith, which would be kind of alarming to think about. But you are changing arenas of service, not leaving ministry. This is why I try never to use the term full-time ministry to describe the pastor of the mission field. And I try never to use the term ministry without a qualifier that tells me what the arena of service is. So, you know, you guys that are in the local church are in pastoral ministry. Missionaries are in evangelistic ministry or, you know, whatever it is. But likewise, our business students, they're going to be in accounting ministry. Or financial services ministry, or marketing ministry. You know, my sons being artists, you know, they're in the entertainment ministry. And my son's in filmmaking ministry. You know, my middle son's in the music ministry, and he's not working for a church. And so what I want to be sure of is that our language reflects our theology on this. And I would urge us to delete from our vocabulary on this things like full-time ministry, secular jobs. You know, if by secular we mean a place where God isn't, there's no such thing as a secular workplace. I get a kick out of people who are saying, you know, help me bring God into the workplace. Well, I got news for you. He's already there. He's way ahead of you, thankfully. And I would urge us to stop talking about higher callings and things like that. I think there are callings that are better for certain individuals because of their gifting. And I would especially encourage us to stop equating spiritual maturity and commitment with where somebody gets a paycheck from. Because that, I think, is Pharisaic legalism, where it's an external standard to govern an internal condition. Because with one exception, with the late Dallas Willard, who was the most Christ-like person I ever knew, but except for him, the most Christ-like people I know today, almost all of them are full-time in the marketplace, navigating how difficult, tricky it is to live out their faith in a way that's consistent. So why don't we've got a couple minutes for some questions. If you want to pursue some of these things a little bit further, this is probably a good time to do that. Well, Gary, either that was clear as mud or I bored them silly. I'm not sure which.
I think it was clear. So who would like to ask the first question? And I see Eddie has a mic over here. Okay, so there's someone right back here. Great. Thanks.
Thank you. My name is John Poros, and I'd like to ask a question. Thank you. My name is John Oros, and I have a question. What is the difference between Christian businessman and a Christian, and the businessman who is a Christian?
I think probably there are times when I would say that's a distinction without a difference. I'd say it depends on what you mean by both of those. What I mean by both of those, a Christian businessman or businesswoman, I would suggest, is somebody who recognizes that the marketplace is one of their primary arenas of service, in a place where they, both by the work that they do and by what they do when they're not doing their job, see that as a place of impact for the kingdom. What I think people mean by the business person who is a Christian is somebody whose faith is not meaningfully integrated into what they do Monday through Friday in the workplace. And if that's how we want to define that, then I think in my church, at least, the majority of people who are in the workplace are business people who also happen to be Christian. And I think our task in the local church is to make that transformation, so that what they do, in the marketplace, is actually integrated with what they do on Sundays. Does that answer your question? Okay.
One more. Yes.
Yes. My name is Jared. Do you see specific times in history or in church tradition where there's been breaks of theology, of work and practice? Does that make sense?
Really good question. Yes. In fact, one of the things that so troubles me about the trend we're seeing today, although I'm encouraged, this is getting a lot better, it seems to me. But one of the troubling parts is that I think we have lost one of the great legacies of the Reformation, is that Luther and Calvin were so committed to the idea that there is such a thing as a worldly calling, and that you did not have to be cloistered in order to have a calling. The caveat there is a lot of the monasteries were actually quite successful businesses. So that dichotomy is not quite as stark as we often make it out to be. But I think for the most part, in the medieval world, priests, nuns, and monks had callings, and everybody else, they were supporting them. And so when Luther came on the scene, that was actually, I think, one of the main theological things that gave impetus to the rise of sort of the modern industrial market system, is because now what entrepreneurial activity had theological legitimacy. Whereas throughout most of church history, business and commerce had been viewed with skepticism, I think because we didn't have an economic system in place where people could do well financially and do good at the same time. That most often, up until about the post-Reformation period, the primary way in which people got wealthy was through, I mean, quite immoral means, by either theft or extortion or misuse of political power. And that, I think, that was the norm in biblical times. It's what economists refer to as a zero-sum arrangement. And I think this is one of the reasons, maybe the main reason, why Jesus made statements like, it's harder for a rich man to enter the kingdom than a camel to go through the eye of a needle. Because there were so few morally legitimate ways to advance your socioeconomic standing. It's also, I think, why the Bible has so little to say about ambition. Because there were so few morally legitimate ways to exercise ambition. Did that answer your question? Okay.
Very good. Do we have one more question? Yes.
Willie Chen. I was just wondering, sometimes people say, I'm a Christian businessman, or I'm a Christian in business, but what does it actually mean to be a Christian? Is he a transformed person, or is he just by name labeled a Christian? Therefore, just like in my case, I thought I was a Christian when I was still working in the workplace, and I wasn't really transformed until I was retired. So that is probably a big issue.
I'm sorry to hear that, actually. But I'd say better late than never. I think the reasons for that, I think, vary widely. I do think that there are some, although I think it's a minority, I think there are some who are in the workplace who have no interest in connecting their faith with what goes on in the workplace. And they want pastors to leave them alone. I think that's a minority. I think most people are like my dad, who desperately wanted to figure this out, but just never got a lot of help. In my view, there are very few things that we can do in our churches that are more important to impact the culture and to impact the city than to help the folks that we serve meaningfully connect what they do in the workplace with the spiritual transformation that we ought to be experiencing. And see, I think the workplace is maybe the primary place where that actually takes place, which is why, you know, those of you who are serving on pastoral staffs or serving in a pastoral function, I would encourage you to make pastoral visits to the workplace and visit people in their offices and find out about their world. We have an assignment for our seminary students that requires them to do that. We actually give them questions to ask because some of them need that. One of the best examples of this is a pastor, you might look him, Tom Nelson. He's a pastor of Christ Community in Kansas City. He said, I'll close with this, the last pastoral visit he made was to a physician in the hospital. But the person wasn't a patient. He said, well, last time I went on pastoral visitation, I scrubbed in and was in surgery right by his side. Now, that assumes that you're not like me and have a queasy stomach for it. But the surgeon, after the pastoral visit, commented to Tom, he said, nobody's ever cared about my work that much. So I suspect that the next time Tom, in his preaching and teaching, is talking about integrating faith in the workplace, that surgeon's going to pay attention because he knows that Tom understands his world. So thanks for sharing that.
All right, let's thank Professor Ray for our
We hope you enjoyed this message. Biola University offers a variety of biblically-centered degree programs, ranging from business to ministry to the arts and sciences. Learn more at biola.edu.